the speaker for the morning, and we're talking about the effect of the eye on conquering chronic disease. And we're going to have just one presenter, Tom Lewis. We're calling up Tom, we'll get started.
Hi folks, thank you for coming. I'm going to talk about the eye as a diagnostic modality for a broad array of neurodegenerative diseases. You know, the eye is really an embryological outcropping of the brain, and compared to the brain, it's clearly the most easily accessible. The lens at the front of the eye is a 50 diopter magnifying glass, so we're already looking at tissue in the back of the eye, for example, which is closest to the brain, with high magnification, so it's a fantastic modality. So let me give you a little history. I'm a medical scientist, PhD from MIT, and I worked, unfortunately, I lived in Boston for too long. Now I moved to Tennessee with my wife, Jasmine, who has a fantastic place to be, but the beauty of being in Boston is I got to work with a couple renegade Harvard MDs for a number of years. One of them is a clinical ophthalmologist, and he just recently retired in June. His name is Dr. Clement Tremp, and the other gentleman I work closely with is the pioneer of the homocysteine theory of cardiovascular disease. That's Dr. Kilman McCulley, who is famous. He won the Linus Pauling Award for the Institute of Functional Medicine and others, and he's really a mechanistic genius. But the special thing about Dr. Tremp and the sad thing about his retirement is that since the 1980s, he has uniquely, as an ophthalmologist, been using the eye as simply a diagnostic tool for systemic inflammatory diseases. And I'm going to go into that in great detail. But the other part of Dr. Tremp is back in the 80s at Scapin's Retina Associates, which was Harvard's boutique ophthalmic practice, he worked side by side with two internal medicine doctors Harvard trained. And in this big practice, none of the ophthalmologists who were doing strict traditional ophthalmology were interested in these internal medicine doctors. So Dr. Tremp, you know, trained in Canada, worked at Mass Eye and Ear for any number of years, but then trained sort of as an internal medicine specialist with this unique look inside the body through the eye. So he's really very, very skilled at that. And one thing, I'll tell you one anecdotal thing that he always used to say, why I enjoy Zach Bush's talks, because he always cracks me up, you know, he's a funny guy. But so this is the thing that Dr. Tremp always used to say. He said, like this, diminutively, I feel sorry for the doctors. I really do, because they're just guessing. Me? He speaks with this French-Canadian accent. Me? I can see the disease right in front of my eyes, so I can see what's going on when I treat, so I know what's going on. And what I love about him, I'd go into his office and he'd have files, patient records this thick. People were sticking with him for 40 years. And what he did is he found how to systemically reverse the most basic neurodegenerative disease, glaucoma. Glaucoma is Alzheimer's disease of the eye, and Alzheimer's is glaucoma of the brain. And anecdotally, his patients would come back to him and say, My eyesight or my loved one's eyesight improved, but also their brain seems to be functioning better. Well, and this is way back in the 80s, and he's just been quietly doing this. And I believe that everybody who's practicing good functional integrative medicine is slowing, stopping, and reversing Alzheimer's disease anyway. So let's get on with the show here, and let's see if we can hit the button right. And so the objectives, which is proper diagnosis of neurodegenerative diseases. And the easiest way to do this on the continuum of disease is look at the eye, look at the outcropping of the brain that's so easily accessible. So the eye provides a means of performing tissue biopsy in the living. You know, there's a few techniques out there, some more or less expensive, to do living biopsies. You know, we look at coronary calcium score, we can look at MRI. So we're looking at, you know, narrow range of tissue opportunities. When we look at the eye, we can see an array of tissue that's unbelievable. And I'm hoping to get into great detail on that. A simple eye exam provides profound information on cardiovascular disease, neurodegenerative disease, and health in general. Of course, we all know they all overlap. OCT, optical coherence tomography. I work with doctors in the area, and OCT, from a tomography perspective, is superior to MRI because of the nature of the light that it uses, which is much shorter wavelength, so it gives much higher resolution. And it's probably about 1/50th the cost of an MRI. So it's much more accurate. I think it's 1,000-fold better than MRI because it's 50 times more accurate or 50 times less expensive and probably 20 times or at least an order of magnitude more accurate. And I have doctors in Orlando who will do an OCT on a patient for me, cash $33. I don't think you can get an MRI for $33. So it's superior. It's never one thing. And if you read the current literature and even the past literature that's going out about these new devices to study neurodegenerative diseases, they're looking at neurodegenerative disease through a telescope. But we know it's a broad spectrum disease. So with the eye, we can look at a myriad of interconnecting pathophysiological changes. So it's not that complicated to run an eye study. I know every doctor has been trained on eye, but a lot of people were a little removed from that training. So partner with an optometrist. They're a perfect diagnostician. They're not going to steal your patient because they're just looking mainly at refraction. But you want to find an optometrist that does pathology, and I'll talk about how to discover that. And interpreting eye data without an eye professional is easier than you think. With today's digital technology, the classic story is my daughter was, when she was 19, worked with Dr. Tremp over the summertime, and he said in a week's time, she was more meticulous and accurate at interpreting, running and interpreting eye scans than 20, 30-year trained technicians. So it's not a complicated thing to do. So I run a couple organizations. Real Health Innovations is a population health management company that works with corporations and anybody where there's a payer system that's aligned with health. So we work with corporations. And then Real Health Clinics, not a lot of people know that, but Dr. Linda King in the back and I launched the first sort of holistic, complete Alzheimer's prevention, detection, reversal clinic in her clinic in Lake Mary, Florida back in 2014. And we're working on expanding that as we speak. So what I want to look at is, Chinese proverb, the best doctor in the world prevents disease. And, a very average doctor manages or reverses disease as it already has developed. So if we look at the continuum, lifestyle begets risks. Risk begets physiological changes. Physiological changes beget pathological changes, and this is a little slice of the eye. And then when pathological changes progress enough to become clinically relevant, we call it disease. But we live in a society that the mantra is instantaneous gratification. I can't compete against for looking at cholesterol or something like that. I can't compete, and you guys can't compete against Actos, Avandia, or niacin at lowering counts, for example, lipid counts. But you can compete against them long-term, when you're measuring mortality, because, all those drugs I just mentioned kill people faster. They do marvelous things internally to our physiology here, but they do horrible things to our pathophysiology. But so we need to be focusing on the continuum, and we know that most risks emanate from lifestyle. And if you listen to Zach Bush's talk earlier, the mother, the birth canal, that whole thing, that's a lifestyle thing, which leads to microbiomal risk, which leads to inflammatory changes in the blood. Oops, here we go. We managed to, someone wants me to speed up this talk, but, to get people motivated in an instantaneous gratification society is we need to show them something exciting and compelling. And one thing about showing someone that even if they feel well, they have a severe disease process going on, the eye provides that modality. Because, you know, just go to Google Images and Google fantastic eye images and look at the eye of a grasshopper, or look at the retina of the human. They're amazing structures. And when they get out a little out of whack, it's very clear and obvious, and you can show a patient, you know, you may feel well, but let's look at your retina, let's look at your cornea, let's look at your lens, the spectacular imagery that this tissue provides us. Okay, and now I clicked it here, that's fantastic. But just, this slide is what we call in medicine ectopic, out of place, but I have to put this slide up here because, you know, in the standard of care, I just was in the den of the devil yesterday in the Villages with a doctor who's a perfect gentleman, but he's doing the bidding of Compass, which has now changed their name, and recruiting the poor villagers into clinical trials to reduce amyloid burden in people that are completely healthy. And what's going to happen, of course, is amyloid is protective, it's antimicrobial, and there are going to be consequences. These people are definitely going to get disease onset earlier than the cohort that's not being treated. But we were there, and I'm not sure if we can uncorrupt this, but you know, amyloid is dead, but amyloid does form in a certain cohort of potential Alzheimer's sufferers and Alzheimer's sufferers, and the main pathology behind these people is infection. And Dr. Tansey at Harvard, I give him no credit because he sat on this data until Bredesen came out, you know, for 20 years, but it's an antimicrobial peptide, the amyloid. And now the next big thing is tau, and tau is actually hyperphosphorylation is upregulated in hibernating animals. And it's very clear that the hyperphosphorylated tau is an energy conservation scheme for a hypoxic brain. So, you know, in Tau RX, I mean, I wish they were publicly traded because I would have shorted them and then I wouldn't be here. I'd be on, Tahiti or something because they obviously failed because it's not the right mechanism. But anyway, but all these pathologies are real and can be used and traced in diagnostics. And yes, they are not treatment targets, but they're a way to measure efficacy of treatment. And we can see all these pathologies very clearly in the eye, and I'll go over that. So this is the importance of amyloid. Amyloid is very important. I mean, look, amyloidosis is happening everywhere. One of my favorite things, the International Alzheimer's Association in 2014 said, oh, we're going to diagnose Alzheimer's because there's more trips and falls and there's loss of weight. You know, they're not eating well. You know, they they don't have the neurological capacity to understand that they're hungry. What they really have is amyloidosis in their muscle tissue, which is waste. It's a wasting disease, and that's really what's going on. So amyloid is present as a protective response to an underlying etiology, and we see that all over the body, not just in the brain. But the profound thing about amyloid is that it shows up as a pathological change well before the onset of clinical symptoms of disease. So it becomes a very important diagnostic tool. Okay. So one thing now, I'm going to sort of transition in talking about the eye as a diagnostic tool, but from a different perspective, from a cost perspective. So, you know, Harvard is pushing the study in the Villages, by the way, on the monoclonal antibody treatment of perfectly healthy individuals. They're also doing the PET scans with the contrasting imaging agents. And, you know, if we look at the escalation of healthcare, I mean, it's obviously a racket. It's a money-making business. You could not screen a population with these tools. It's just too expensive. $8,000, $10,000 a head. But at $30 a head with OCT, you could screen populations. And we're seeing much more profound information, which I'll show you with OCT, than you'll ever see with a PET scan and a contrast dye. So, you know, we're not only do we have a very profound diagnostic, but it's extremely cost effective. Okay, well, I'm clicking the wrong button here. So just some slides showing and confirming what Zach was talking about is that, you know, we see this escalation in chronic diseases around the 1940s, 50s, and Maynard Murray wrote a beautiful patent in 1963 about the loss of nutrients in our soil. And look, every disease is connected to the health of our milieu, which is then tied to inflammation and the antecedents of that. But we see this profound interconnection of the escalation of these diseases. And the New York Times was astute enough to say that, boy, in the senior population, hey, what the heck, we're actually seeing an overlap. And, you know, you may not be able to treat dementia without treating vascular diseases. So, you know, this popular information is out there, it's just not practiced in the standard of care. So this is Clayton Christensen. He wrote The Innovator's Dilemma, and then he wrote this article in 2003 or 4 timeframe about how will disruptive innovations change healthcare. And one of the big impediments, he says, is healthcare is the most entrenched, change-averse industry in the world, and they'll shut anything good down. And I noticed that over the last 20 years, the allopathic doctors are always saying, no, we cannot delegate this level of diagnostic acumen to lower and lower levels. Well, guess what? It's erupting through health coaches, navigators, and all other populations. So now my population health consultant is being interviewed by the AMA because they got to try to get on the bus. But we need simple, profoundly diagnostic technologies to really move the needle towards that lifestyle, towards prevention, and the eye is one such thing. So really the panacea, I'm gonna give a talk to A4M, and I know a lot of people are co-members, and it's called Back to the Future Medicine, and we can't go back to Marcus Welby, because as compared to back in the 60s, there's so much media being thrown at us with financial incentives and disincentives towards health. So the only way we're really gonna overcome that uprising health problems is through education. And a doctor in a short visit doesn't have the opportunity to do that. So the army that do this is gonna be coaches and navigators. And if you can provide great technology and diagnostic tools down to lower and lower levels of practitioners and non-practitioners, this is the place to be. And in our corporate world, we're competing with clinical management companies that are bringing allopaths in, and we're working side by side with them. And we spend probably 50% of our time just helping the individual that works with us overcome the madness they've been taught by the allopath. So it's a challenging thing. But our coaches far excel the traditional specialists at making people well. So now let's segment into the eye, and let's, you know, I picked this slide because it shouldn't be mysterious, and I'm going to try to demystify the pathologies that present in the eye that are extremely easy to understand and extremely predictive towards future health. So first of all, we look at the profound connection between the eye and the brain. It's an embryological outcropping of the brain, and the signaling crosses multiple synaptic junctions. So it's, you know, if there's something going on in the brain, it's being reflected back into the eye and vice versa. So here's a few favorite quotes. The eye is quite literally a real window to the rest of the body. The retina is actually a piece of the brain that is grown into the eye. I love that one. And diagnosing illness through the eye is nothing new. Nothing new to optometrists and ophthalmologists. And I want to differentiate between the two. Ophthalmologists are MDs that focus on eye diseases, whereas obviously optometrists are not MDs. But in the world where there can be some compatibility between integrative doctors and eye doctors, the place to be is with optometrists, because they are your diagnostic specialists. You know, ophthalmologists are really surgeons. That's their main function and duty. And I'll be talking about what ophthalmology should look like, but oh well. So here's my favorite, talking about a living biopsy. Where else can you see a bare nerve, a bare artery, and a bare vein? And what's going on in the eye is certainly going on in the rest of the body. I mean, a red blood cell right now is coursing through my heart, and in a minute's time, maybe I'm a little more excited than you folks, so it's going every 30 seconds, but it's certainly coursing very quickly. I mean, this is panacea for cardiologists. I don't have to rip open your chest. I can just look in the back of the eye, and I'll show you atherosclerotic plaque formation in the eye that's so easy to detect. Not to mention that we can see the nervous tissue at the exact same time. So here's, you know, for neurodegenerative disease, particularly Alzheimer's, pupillary movement portends Alzheimer's. The lens, there's not a lot of studies on this, but this was done at Harvard. And what they showed in this study is that not only does the lens change in the terms of forming plaques, they match 100% to the brain plaques, and even the fluid, the cerebrospinal fluid and the intraocular fluid match for amyloid precursor and amyloid protein. So the retina is really the outcropping of the brain, optic disc that's part of the retina. We'll go over these things. So, you know, the reason why I'm kind of harping on multifactorial assessment, and the eye should be part of it. Once again, if you're doing blood tests, that's great, but an eye test is a pathological evaluation, much closer to disease. So this is our favorite little cartoon because we have clients that are on weight loss programs, for example, and being treated by allopaths. Hey, my A1C came down. Great. So they just figured out it's a tail. It's a rope. You know, here's the blind guys. Is there a blind lady there? Yeah. So five blind guys and a blind lady trying to figure out what this beast is. And if you take any one of these pieces in isolation, you have no clue what it is. But if you have all the pieces of the whole, you might be able to figure it out. And so, you know, the eye is a part of that whole. The stool test, yes. The blood test, yes. The urine test, yes. The calcium score. But the eye is an extremely valuable piece to this puzzle to figure out the disease. And you just go on Google and, you know, images and put in the elephant metaphor and you'll get this. But, my point was, everybody in these weight loss programs, A1C went down. So if that's all you're measuring, success. And we're trying to convince the weight loss folks that, So the ones that overlap in our program, all their inflammatory markers went up. Their A1C came down because they're not getting as much glucose, but all the inflammatory markers go up because they're malnourished. So, and this is just a slide. The symphony is sort of our, along with the elephant, it's our other metaphor. Every time you do multiple tests, you get much more profound information on what to do. And what I say is when we're working with individuals, it's the constellation. So if you go to a symphony and you hear the music, you hear them warming up, you know, it may sound a little disjointed. But then towards the end, when the performance is ready to go, all of a sudden it breaks into harmony. It's the same with reducing risks in an individual, and it's same in terms of doing multiple diagnostics. So you can do one diagnostic, you have one little piece of information. But when you start getting more and more and more, you get this Gaussian exponential amplification of the value of the data. So we need to do more testing. We need to, you know, in our patient cohorts that we coach, we remove one risk, no big deal. But when we start removing multiple risks, the symphony now starts playing in perfect harmony. And that's kind of how we view things. And just so you know, the eye's been around for a while. I mean, these are interesting books. Daniel Gold is the Eye and Systemic Disease, just released recently. Amazing photography. But these books have been around for 20 or so years. And then this is John Darling in my book on Alzheimer's that we published in 2014. I say, you know, he's no rookie, he's a chair professor at Harvard, and it's very clear that the retina is the approachable part of the brain, and it provides excellent material for studying progression and regression of neurodegenerative diseases. So I'm getting back to my forensic files again, and you know, this is clearly the most important place if we can get people to move with lifestyle. But when you look at the eye, we might be able to motivate them to say, hey, this is the process, and you get some trouble. We want to prevent you from going to the next step. So I want to go over at a high level, level A eye test, level B more complicated eye test, and level C. So once again, there's a lot of literature out there. Oh, we're designing this new machine to look at one little slice of the retina to diagnose neurodegenerative disease. Completely. Necessary and myopic. You got to look at the constellation of things. So the first thing is simple microscopy. Everybody's had a slit lamp microscope view. It's really looking at for cataracts, for unfolded proteins in the eye. Every optometrist in the country, 38,000 of them, and there are more optometric, more eye visits than there are to primary care, have a slit lamp microscope. Very simple, and we're looking for nuclear cataracts, posterior capsular cataracts, and cortical cataracts. Now, the next device, which may not be in every optometrist's office, but probably half of them, is a fundus camera. It's just looking at the health. It's just a camera looking at the back of the eye and under high magnification, and we can see some amazing things back there. And drusen is the number one thing we're looking for. And you know, if you know what a round sphere looks like, and you know what the color yellow or orange is, you can diagnose drusen. And it's extremely profound in terms of predicting neurodegenerative disease downstream. And then OCT, where we really can look at the fine detail, the tomography, not just seeing things, but we can see them three-dimensionally. We can measure thickness. We can follow degradation. We can follow degeneration. We can follow regeneration very accurately. And well, these require dilation, but OCT instruments are so precise now that we can look right inside the narrow pupil and without dilation and see some of these features as well with this one instrument. And then these are things that are less well understood, or you know, and the reason why a lot of them have gone away is they're not reimbursed, or some instruments are reimbursed, but the cost of supplies are more expensive than the reimbursement, so they're not being done anymore. But a pentacam is simply, it gives us the entire profile of misfolded protein in a lens. Microperimeter, one of my favorites. It's like, I think it should, every athletic trainer and you know high-level decision maker in sport should be using this, because basically we're looking at the six muscles controlling the movement of the pupil. And it's almost like a bullseye. We can measure the ability of someone to control movement extremely accurately. I don't have to look at tremor. We can just look at the finest motor control as measured by the control of the six muscles that control the focus of the eye. We're looking at eye movement. Laser Doppler, I can actually look at capillary blood flow going to the brain, and this has been published for a long time, the lack of blood flow tied to, or the reduction in blood flow through the retina tied to neurodegenerative conditions. Just simply looking at visual fields, loss of peripheral vision, implying the earliest incidence of glaucoma. Pupil movement, Sean Frost out in Australia did his thesis on this. It's tied to plaque burden, and then VEP is simply looking at electrical response signaling from the retina to the visual cortex. And then some other instruments that are a little more esoteric, multifocal ERG. I think this is the coolest instrument out there. Anybody know what this instrument is? No show of hands. So what it does, little electrode across the eye, and it measures really your first experience or interaction with the outside environment in terms of photons. So it measures how quickly you turn a photon into an electron right at the retina. So imagine an Olympic athlete doing the parallel uneven bars or something and flipping in the air. If they don't have a very fast conversion, and everybody has a different conversion, of that photon to an electron they're gonna lose their spatial relationship while they're up in the air and probably not land right. So a classic photograph that Dr. Tramp usually presents is a 14-year-old Chinese gal admiring her gold medal and the 19-year-old American looking down at her bronze medal. And the difference is the multifocal ERG response of those two people, because at 14, you're optimal. And we start declining, sorry to say that, from a neuronal electric photoelectric response at that age. So, and a couple other instruments we won't go into detail. Oh yeah, this one here I should mention is, you know, the next big thing in Alzheimer's is looking at the health of microtubules and tau protein and phosphorylation of the tau protein. We can measure that with this instrument extremely accurately, and I'll obviously get into that in more detail. So if I can compel you to send patients to an eye doctor, and a lot of insurances cover the doctor visit, I would recommend you go to Vision Source, which is essentially a buying association, because they need to compete against Pearle Vision for contact lenses. But what they've really done is they've created a higher level of learning within the optometry profession. So most of the Vision Source doctors, so you see we have 35,000 optometrists and 3,300 Vision Source doctors, eye doctors. They're trained to a higher level. Most of them do pathology. Most of them will have the big three instruments, the slit lamp, the fundus camera, and the OCT. So Dr. Mark Perry, right down the road, he's like 3 miles from here, he's doing the OCT for me for $33. Now, he'll do a complete eye exam, which includes refraction and the slit lamp and the fundus camera and the OCT and whatever else he feels like throwing at the patient for $125. Complete exam. And these doctors know how to read pathology. So everything I'm saying today, they're not sharing it because, you know, we have a medical system that's so segmented, but they can interpret the pathology for you. They're very astute docs, or we can do it, because we're expert at that, obviously, as well. So how does the eye really tie back to the genesis of disease? Well, you know, Zach Bush, listen to his talk. I mean, inflammation is a treasure. You know, when you get older, 70, 80, 90, 100, 235, you're going to have more inflammation, because as your primary immune system, primary and secondary immune system starts waning, you have tertiary mechanisms that come to play to keep you alive. One of them is inflammation. We don't want to downregulate that. One of them is cholesterol. You know, the statistics are very clear. 70 and older, if your cholesterol is 240 or above, there's 4 deaths per 1,000, 100 patient years. If your cholesterol is 160 or less, is 11 deaths per 100 patient years. Why is that cholesterol coming out to play? Because our primary immunity is declining, so this is God's way to keep us healthy to the very end. So we can, you know, we can measure inflammatory responses very precisely in the eye. And this, Lisa Wade was kind enough to update my talk yesterday, because this came out. Nothing new, but when it comes out in time, you know, on New York Times Well blog, November 1st, 2017, inflammation in midlife is tied to brain shrinkage later in life. And of course, the worst thing you can do is directly downregulate inflammation. Dr. Tramp called me one time. He says, Tom, you can't believe this. They have a new drug to downregulate TNF-alpha. That's horrible. That's horrible. You're going to do it naturally. You got to find the underlying cause of the TNF-alpha escalation and treat it there. But, you know, it's pretty clear. That if you're young and you have high levels of inflammation, it's a very simple thing. How robust is your immune system? I equated in a little video we did on our site. It's like Arnold Schwarzenegger curling a 10-pound weight. He can do it forever. That's a system. There's no inflammation. Whereas you get the classic 98-pound weakling, that muscle is going to go into tremor very quickly. It's a weak immune system. So really, all inflammation is, early in life, is a measure of the robustness of your immune system. Because we're all, you know, obviously we're all experiencing different environments and we have, you know, different milieus. But for the most part, you know, Gaussian statistics, the bell curve, we're all experiencing the same mess out there. So those with more inflammation are just weaker. It's as simple as that. And we've developed tools, which I'll talk about at the end, about how to measure that accurately and make it really sticky for patients. So that just hot off the presses. Hot off the presses. Okay, I have to go on a little diatribe. So, you know, I'm an MIT alum, and they're constantly, I'm ashamed of my alma mater because they're not doing anything real. But the technology school should be doing something real. Let the theoretical schools do the esoteric stuff. So this fancy dean says, you know, discovered the first link between neurodegenerative disease and immune health. And I had it right back, and I always carbon copy the president, Reif. And I said, ma'am, you need to retract that statement and apologize to Claude Bernard from 19th century France, who coined the term milieu intérieur, because you were scooped by 150 years. You know, we it's very clear that we understand that our terrain has everything to do with health. All we're doing with the eye is a barometer to help you measure where people are in that health disease continuum. So, inflammation in the eye. I love this title. Did God sell the eye to the devil? The Faustian dilemma? Think about it. If you bang your eye and you have an inflammatory response, you won't be able to see. Because of the fine focal arrangement in the eye. So the eye has made a little compromise with the world of inflammation so that you maintain your vision, because vision is more important to survival than a little inflammation, which, you know, your body may be able to manage later on as you get healthy. So the eye, in fact, is quasi-immunosuppressed. So now we have two benefits from the eye. Several benefits. Cost. Two, accessibility. Everything we do with the eye is non-invasive, except the treatments, which are ill-founded. And it's immunosuppressed, so it's actually literally the canary for inflammation. So anything that's happening in the eye from a neurodegenerative perspective is happening simultaneously, but more advanced and maybe more rapidly than is happening in the brain. So it's a really good diagnostic. You know, how I got into this business, I've always been interested in it, but around 15 years ago, my dad died of Alzheimer's, and 14 years ago, I met Dr. Tremp. Well, what did he have before Alzheimer's? He had glaucoma. And suddenly the light, you know, Google glaucoma and Alzheimer's. It's so clear that it's the same pathophysiology, same thing that's going on. So if you're in the know, someone has glaucoma, they're way early in the Alzheimer's process. Now is the time not to treat the eye, but to go evaluate the milieu and figure out what's going on. So this is glaucoma is pre-mild cognitive impairment. And it's not just Alzheimer's, it's all the neurodegenerative conditions. They all overlap. It's just a question of what place in the tissue milieu where you have the most inflammation. So that's what the eye does for us. And this is the Harvard guy. So now, the eye through the ages. You know, Dr. Tremp says you start preventing Alzheimer's with the unborn child. And there's no question about that. And so what is the standard of care clinicians doing out there? Please, if you have pregnant ladies in your, or of childbearing age ladies in your practice, make them aware that their traditional doctors are going to say, no fish oil for you. So I asked the doctor in this clinic that we're working against, you know, with the cohort, but I asked him, why no fish oil? Well, because during delivery, there's excess bleeding. And my scientific mind, which doesn't have to be very brilliant at this point, says, Why is there excess bleeding? It's, well, maybe because there's not enough, not a sufficient amount of K1 or K2, not enough vegetables. Maybe we should give fish oil and vegetables to the pregnant women and not prevent them from having fish oil to develop the strong neuronal networks in the child. So get them that, you know, find your mercury-free fish oil. We prefer cod liver oil. We do, we're finding very profound effects with what I call therapeutic cod liver oil. So if you read the Framingham study, you give one capsule. In 1848, in British hospitals, treating consumption, spitting blood tuberculosis, between 15 and 40 grams a day of pretty nasty, at that time, cod liver oil, was reducing hospital mortality by a factor of 3. Okay, so these are important things. The vitamin A, it's hard to get vitamin A like you can get in cod liver oil. That's what makes cod liver oil superior to fish oils, is the natural form of vitamin D and the natural forms of vitamin A found in that substance. So what I want to point out here is this is a little section of the retina, back of the eye. These are your photoreceptors, the ganglion cells. But this is something called the Bruch's membrane. And the choroidal membrane here, this is where all the blood flow is. And it's interesting that the disease process starts right in the membrane being nourished directly by the capillaries. So it proves the thesis of Dr. Della Torre, senior editor of the Alzheimer's Journal of Alzheimer's Disease and many others, that all these neurological conditions are vascular first. And this is the beginning of a plaque. It's called drusen. So we're seeing soft drusen forming underneath the retina, very easily seen with the simple tomography and simple photo lenses. And now even the iPhone has a way to do a retinal image. And if there's a soft drusen or prominent enough, large enough, you can see them. But this is where the rubber is hitting the road, so to speak. But the interesting thing is males, we'll pick on the males because that was a study, at 54, like Zach said, looks like everybody here is 35, but when you get up to 54, get an eye exam, and if you have soft drusen, very easy to see, guess who's heading down the path of neurodegenerative disease? The 10% of those males with soft drusen, those are the ones that are going to progress to either macular degeneration or glaucoma, but clearly into another neurodegenerative state. So I love this curve because it tells us that macular disease follows a simple geometric progression, which follows the immune system health. So I work, one of the contracts I have is with a casket company. And the line workers building the caskets know a heck of a lot more about immune health than the doctors treating them, because they know in the wintertime more small caskets are ordered because of influenza death, okay? Because we have an immature immune system. You know, the second you cut that umbilical cord and you're not breastfeeding, your immune system goes from healthy to extremely immature. And so there are a lot of deaths early on. But there's the curve for influenza deaths. You know, at around age 60, 65, it's sort of an asymptotic curve. Now, the proof is the blue is a perfect geometric progression, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, so on and so forth. And the red curve is incidence of age-related macular degeneration. Perfectly fits with a decline in your immune health. So it's a profound measurement. So if someone's getting macular disease in their 50s, they got a lousy immune system. It's a one-for-one geometric correlation, very simple. My wife and I haven't had a lot of time recently because of work and our health ministry, but we We did a little health ministry for a while at our church in Tennessee. And the assistant pastor who was in charge of small groups said, you know, like, why would I want to live longer? Don't you live more miserably? And this is a really neat article from National Geographic, 2013, May edition. And this gentleman team from National Geographic went around the world to look at centenarians to see what was special about their genes. And I love the quote is, they said, well, maybe genes are only 25% of the picture anyway. Of course, we're not talking about epigenetics, which is all lifestyle driven. And the other part is luck. And I'm saying, luck is just a lack of good measurement to figure out what the heck's going on and try to correct that path. But the point's very poignant. You know, if you're gonna live to 120, when you're 60, you're not chronically sick. If you're gonna live to 80, maybe when you're 60, you're starting to be truly chronically sick. So if you live to 80, you're gonna have 19 years of declining health. And once again, it's sort of an asymptotic curve. But if you live to 105, you're only gonna have 9 years of declining health. So your health span is 30 years, even though your lifespan is 20, 25 years. So we have every incentive to improve the level of our milieu and our health. So just to motivate, because they say, why do I want to live longer? Because you're going to live healthier. It's as simple as that. And Nat Geo laid it out for us very nicely. So now we're going to actually dig into pathology rather than talking in high-level terms. And so the first place I'm going to start is with the lens. And the lens, very simple instrument. Here's Victor and Dorothy doing a little slit lamp measurement. And all the slit lamp does is literally send a slit of light beam into the clear lens and across the, I'm forgetting the name of it, the cornea. There we go. So just like if I have a slit of light coming into the room now, we might expose the dust. All the slit lamp microscope does is expose the abnormal opaque formations in the eye, and the ones we're really interested in are misfolded or unfolded proteins. So nobody studied this. Just kidding. So this is the National Institute of Health, the age-related eye disease study. And what they really set out to do is prove that these supplements, zinc and retinoic acid and things of that nature, lutein, zeaxanthin, antioxidants, profoundly affect the progression of these severe eye diseases. And of course they don't. You know, the underlying mechanism is much more complex than just throwing a few antioxidants at the individual. But in the process of doing this, they found something very surprising, that eye diseases are deadly. And most people with eye diseases die of cardiovascular disease. And they die at a very high rate, much higher than breast cancer, 2.5-3 times a higher rate. And I always ask people, anybody been on a cataract walk? Anybody, show of hands. You've been on a, you're my man, we'll talk afterwards, but yeah. And obviously we've been on breast cancer walks, but cataracts are much more, what's the number one surgery in the world? So we're taking a beautiful biomarker, a beautiful misfolded protein, and throwing it into the hazardous waste trash with no consideration for what that biomarker means prospectively to the individuals upon whom we remove that misfolded, unfolded protein. Why is it unfolded? Why do we have an opaqueness in our eye, in our lens? Why? Someone please answer that question and you'll get to the root of why that person's sick and be able to help them. So it's a big study, National Institute of Health, Frank Ferris, and I've talked to all these people, and you know, we're so siloed, it's sad that these eye doctors don't get to spend time with you folks. So here's the detail of the study. You know, we won't talk about age-related macular disease, but just sudden vision loss, 36% in 6-year mortality. Cataract surgery, 55%. Just one nuclear opacity. Zinc helps a little bit, basic supplements don't help much. So we're not moving the needle on mortality for these for these conditions. But they are very, very deadly. And so here's a little closer look up of mortality versus time for these types of things. So cataract surgery usually means it's bilateral, both eyes. We have two eyes. It's a blessing. Very few studies. Let's just keep doing more research. I consider myself a translator. I don't want to do any research. I want to work with doctors to translate best of breed information to help patients. We have enough information. It's all out there. So, but look at all these studies. Every one of these studies comes to one conclusion. Cataracts are a profound marker of early mortality, and it's all cardiovascular. And then once again, thank you, Lisa Wade, because this came out 2 days ago, and we need to pay close, I can't leave the podium, very sad. We need to pay close attention to this. Ebola's legacy, children with cataracts. Cataracts usually afflict the old, but doctors in Africa have been shocked, because they don't understand mechanisms of disease, to find them in Ebola survivors as young as five. So what that tells us is that misfolded protein that we can see in the eye is an inflammatory condition that's tied to infection. And what is tied to infection? A lousy immune system. We're all in an infectious milieu. So here's Ebola accelerating the misfolded protein response. So I thought that was a pretty cool thing, and they're trying to show that she has a little nuclear cataract in her central visual field. Oh yeah, I have to point this way. So there's a bunch of different cataracts, and we have the nuclear, and in the eye doctor world, we worry about nuclear because it affects central vision. Light's coming in, focal plane, right back to the fovea in the back of the eye. Light's not getting through, you're not seeing. But these cataracts on the periphery, called supranuclear or cortical cataracts, are very common, but a lot of eye doctors don't look for them, and that is the Alzheimer's cataract, no ifs, ands, or buts. If you have the progression of a cortical cataract, you have Alzheimer's disease. It's the same exact thing. And I'll express my anger with the evil empire of Harvard, because this paper was published in 2003, and what it showed is that in autopsied patients, the fluid in the eye and the cerebral spinal fluid and the pathology of amyloid plaques in the brain and in the cortical cataract are exactly the same. So what did Harvard do? They've now messed around for 14 years trying to form a company doing Raman spectroscopy, trying to develop a 510K device to measure these cortical cataracts, and they tried to patent the entire eye, by the way. Instead of, like Mass General, you know this is the truth, set up a clinic to screen the population for supranuclear cataracts. They haven't done one. They haven't done one, you know, but they've done the PET scan, you know, Risa Sperling and Dennis Selko, criminals. It's just being aired, I hope. You know, on the Pittsburgh dyes and all this, just look for supranuclear cataracts. It's the Alzheimer's cataract, and it's showing up 20 years before you have disease. So this is Harvard's work, and this is a nuclear cataract. There's a lens. And then on the periphery, we see this new formation, this supranuclear cortical cataract. And the optometrists have these neat red light tools to really accentuate the cortical cataract. Once again, if you go for an eye exam today and they look at your lens with a slit lamp, they're not looking for the cortical cataract. You have to pretty much ask them to it. They know it's there. But you need to be a little, you have to put a little more light in, so a little more light intensity, and it's a little bothersome. The patients don't like the light in their eyes, so they tend not to do that. And you need to make sure it's well dilated and look out in the periphery. But see, cortical cataracts are just observed because they essentially never impact vision. And eye doctors are all about the vision, so we don't do it. So this is a very cool slide, because this is some geek pathologist spent a lot of time sectioning, and not, did I insult any pathologists in the audience? Sorry about that. Sectioning the brain with amyloid plaques, trying to find that perfect fibril, staining it and all that. Who knows how long it took to do this? This is using a slit lamp microscope properly and seeing a Alzheimer's fibril in the cortex of the lens in a living patient. It's human biopsy of Alzheimer's disease. And of course, you don't catch Alzheimer's, you don't catch cardiovascular disease, you don't catch diabetes. These are progressive degenerative conditions. You don't catch a cortical cataract, it progresses. And the earliest progression is what's called comorbidation. We're looking at just the earliest changes of amyloid in the lens that's just leading to a little swelling. And we have an instrument where it's like putting oil on water. You see a sheen and you just can see slight motility changes in the lens. And then we have something that's called pseudoexfoliation, which is, oopsie, wrong clicker, is just a sort of the Milky Way aggregation of microparticles of amyloid that progress into the fibrils to spokes to a cortical cataract. Very few people go to this progression to this level. They've died of vascular disease or Alzheimer's. People with spokes are in severe cognitive decline. These people are probably in mild cognitive impairment. That's generically what the progression looks like. So this is an instrument that measures that earliest swelling. And no one's going to do this. This is a research instrument. It's not being used. But what it does is gives us very fine imagery of optical aberrations tied to the lens. And LASIK doctors will use this before they do LASIK surgery on you because they're doing LASIK surgery on the cornea. But if your lens is swelling, then in 6 months, if it continues to swell, you're going to be extremely agitated with your LASIK surgeon because your vision's going to go blurry again. So credible LASIK surgeons are looking to see if there are lens changes and will probably refer you to not having the surgery until you can correct the degenerative problem, which they don't understand, that's underlying it. So here's another instrument. So Harvard didn't need a fancy instrument to measure cataract. This is called a pentacam, and it measures across the entire radius and diameter of the lens and looks for misfolded or unfolded proteins. This is a nuclear cataract, that's a cortical cataract, very easily seen. But you know, the slit lamp microscope, $6,000 device, work with your optometrist, can detect all these things. So now let's go away from the front of the eye where the lens is to the back of the eye, the real brain of the eye, the real canary for your brain. So I'm back to the ARID study, and this is the one, AMD, age-related macular disease, and we see how deadly this disease is along with cataract. So what we're seeing here is the different stages of age-related macular disease as it ties to increased mortality. Now, this would be considered the dry AMD. There's much higher mortality compared to normal individuals without dry AMD. But in the standard of care, we just monitor it because only about 15-20% progress to the wet form. Some of them die, some of them get healthy. You know, there's any number of reasons why you don't progress into the more advanced stage. But if we look at this slide here, we're seeing a little yellow globule called drusen. Just a fundus camera. It's as plain as the nose on my face, which is, you know, Polish, so it's pretty prominent. You can see the drusen very clearly. Any optometrist can see it. And this right here is a little spot of blood where the vasculature underlying the retinal, the pigment epithelial layer. Just like if your gums bleed, okay? When you floss and your gums bleed, the capillaries in the gums are weak enough to break down, then fibrin seals the problem back up. This is the same exact process is happening in the eye, and it's pretty clear it's infectious, it's immune dysfunction, but we can see that very clearly. The sad thing is, in the standard of care, and doctors make a lot of money at this, do the Lucentis injections. They're doing the anti-VEGF, so the anti-stopping the endothelial vascular endothelial growth factor. What they don't realize, and the Lucentis study showed this, is that when you inject anti-VEGF in the eye goes everywhere. So what you see downstream when you treat a patient this way, and the reason why you do that is the new vessels that form to circumvent the fact that the existing vessels are getting unhealthy, collateral vessels kind of block vision. So the goal of ophthalmology is to shrink those vessels to restore a meager amount of vision. It's not having any effect on the neurodegenerative health of the eye, but what happens is the anti-VEGF goes into circulation, and that people that would normally, if they had a heart event, would just have a little angina, actually pass on because the body is not able to form collateral vessels. We've shut down VEGF. So this is exactly what is happening. There's the vascular tissue, and there's the nervous tissue, the nexus of the two in the eye, and the exact same thing is happening within the brain at capillary nerve junctions. So the drusen, we see a little amyloid deposit, and that's all it is, and we can see that very accurately. But then as we progress, we're basically forming a cardiovascular vulnerable plaque. That's all a wet AMD pathology is. It's a vulnerable plaque. We just happen to be able to see it very clearly in the back of the eye underlying the retina. So we can see it, we see bleeding, and we see drusen. It's very simple test, a fundus camera. So this is Professor Don Anderson. He's only spent 25, 30 years studying drusen. And what he's shown is that inside these drusen globules is the beta amyloid protein. So dry AMD is the first indication in the neurodegenerative process towards amyloid deposition of that formation. We can see it very clearly. So I throw Dr. McCulley up, one of my mentors, because this paper is, and you know, I guess you can download these talks, but if there's any paper I'd read, it would be this one, because the entire genesis of disease is happening in the microvasculature. Okay, so you go to the doctor's office and we have these beautiful pictures of the big vessel and this plaque being built up. Well, there was a little German, I don't know if he was little, but a little German doctor who showed unequivocally, a pathologist, that the real disease etiology is in the small vessels or the large vessels. So every disease is a disease, you know, at your home, the big pipes don't clog up first, it's the little pipes. And Alzheimer's is a disease of the capillaries. We can't see capillaries with MRIs, so we just see these obtuse atrophy, but it's really happening in the small vasculature. Heart disease, the exact same thing. It's all happening in the microvasculature. So Koester publishes paper in some German journal in 1876. So in 1876, Dr. Koester recognized that the whole genesis of vascular disease emanates from the outside in the vasa vasorum. So all it says, that's the link between vascular disease and Alzheimer's. It's a disease of the microvascular, it's a disease of the capillaries. And that's why OCT is superior to MRI, because OCT can see capillaries down to the micron level, and MRI cannot. All I can see is gross structure. So it's a great paper. He really boils it down in terms of mechanism, not about the eye. This is general cardiovascular disease, homocysteine, C-reactive protein, those kinds of things. So we've known about the eye, the glaucoma, and the Alzheimer's connection since 2003. Now it's pretty much been proven. It's the same etiology. So if you know anybody with glaucoma, if they live long enough, they're on the path to Alzheimer's disease. If they don't make correction, they're on the way to Alzheimer's disease. So it's something we need to pay attention to. Very simple. You don't need an eye doctor relationship. Someone comes in with macular disease or glaucoma, it's time to figure out what's going on with that patient and not just worry about some eye drops. We've got to go beyond that. So glaucoma is a pretty insidious disease, and it's much more prevalent than Alzheimer's. You know. So this is a paper done at the New England College, a dissertation. There's a very clear connection between the thickness of the retinal nerve fiber layer, which is what is really the diagnosis for glaucoma, and Alzheimer's, a very high correlation between the two instances. Oops, who did I shine my light on? So just looking at some of the research, very clear that the retinal nerve fiber layer thickness of Alzheimer's patients is much thinner. And we can measure that thickness very accurately. OCT is non-invasive visualization of axons, of ganglion cells, and a lot of stuff on multiple sclerosis. And OCT is a very dynamic tool to measure progression, regression. So this is what an OCT instrument looks like. It's very simple. It's probably a Zeiss or a Topcon. And we look into it just like you would for any ophthalmic or optometric evaluation. You look in and at a spot in the back, and we're just doing imagery. And we get these extremely micron-level rich pathological slices of the nervous tissue. So this is a profile, and we're seeing the retinal ganglion cells, we're seeing the nerve fiber layer, we're seeing the vasculatures down here, and if there are any macular disease formations, it's right in this layer. So we're seeing a very rich profile of the retina, great detail. But from a doctor perspective, it's so simple. The instruments take the raw data on the right and transfer it into just a thickness or a volume map in terms of quadrants. I love that advertisement for that blood pressure thing. You know, it's as easy as this. Green, yellow, red. We're doing the eye instrumentation companies are doing the exact same thing. Yellow implies that we have a loss of normal thickness. And these measurements are all age-related. You have to put your date of birth in. So it's all done against a cohort of common age individuals. So if you're seeing yellow or red in your scan, it's compared against your age mates, not against 20-year-olds. So it's very relevant to your particular cohort. And most of these instruments now, you don't even have to put the name in once it's in once, retinal identification. They know it's you. So it's an extremely good tool for mapping over time. It's a great way to get a baseline. Send your patients with potential neurodegenerative disease, concern about neurodegenerative disease, or neurodegenerative disease to get an OCT and start mapping it out. And you will see changes. Wow, I'm getting down on time, so I'm going to run through some slides. This is just same thing. We're seeing deterioration in the nerve fiber layer. A recent study, 2016, shows that the reliability of OCT in measuring brain transformations is there, and it's relatively inexpensive. This is a paper everybody should look at. He cured his wife, and then he treated people with multiple sclerosis for many years. He just retired. David Weldon, if you Google David Weldon and MS, he shows a profound relationship between chlamydophilia pneumoniae and multiple sclerosis. And we're seeing the same pathology in Alzheimer's. So just more scans. I'll move through. So Chris Christopherson diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. He really had Lyme disease, but the Lyme disease caused the Alzheimer's. They're intimately connected. This is what a Lyme disease patient looks like from the quadrant measurements in OCT. And you know, these are changes. That's why you need to baseline. Everybody starts at a different level. Baseline them and follow them down. We're just looking at thickness measurements. The important thing that we found recently, and it's out in the literature, is that depression, bipolar disorder, these are organic diseases. And we can see neurological changes in the back of the eye. So patients with bipolar disease have a thinner retinal nerve fiber layer, very similar to Alzheimer's. People with Alzheimer's don't get depressed. They were depressed already. They had neuroinflammation. Yeah, the Alzheimer's is exacerbating their cups flowing over more, but they already had Alzheimer's. They already had depression. That is an early warning sign of neurodegenerative disease. So OCT we can measure the severity of these disorders, major depressive orders, by looking at the changes in the retina or retinal nerve fibrillar thickness with OCT. And I'll just quickly go over tau. It's the microtubules, the railways and the structural components of neurons. And they're so orderly that they cause the polarization of light. And through the eye, you can measure the disruption of these highly ordered microtubules when they become hypophosphorylated with optical instruments, just looking at the changes in the polarization of light. So it's an extremely interesting thing. So you get rid of inflammation. Here's the heart. We have unfolded protein response, New England Journal of Medicine. You have unfolded protein in your lens of your eye, in your brain, and in your heart as well. So here's Dr. McClosey. She wrote in 1993, Alzheimer's disease is spirochetosis, highly correlated. That's the etiology of the neuroinflammation. So I'm in the red. I'm a disciple of Claude Bernard. If you don't know what you're looking for, you're not going to find it. An eye is a great place to look. You don't have a sick eye in a healthy body. It's a sick eye in an unhealthy body. Sick eye in a sick body.
Great. Thank you very much. We've got some time for a few quick questions.
First of all, when you treat the right things, do you track reversal in the optical, in the OTC?
Great, yes. On the OTC, you can see changes. Now, pathological changes take longer, obviously, than physiological changes. So it really, I hate to use the magic word depends, but neurogenesis is real, and it's real in the retina, too. And I didn't get to it, but I actually had a slide down here a little, I might have skipped over it, that shows actual regrowth and volume increase in the retina, no question about it. We've even seen cataract reversal. Now, the interesting thing about cataract is you have a very, a lens is a giant stem cell. And you have all the progenitor cells in the periphery, and it's the largest chunk of avascular tissue in our body. So the chaperoning in and out of repair mechanisms in the lens is extremely slow. But even in cataract, Dr. Tramp has seen reversal of the unfolded protein response in the lens.
So my other question is, there's been at least one study showing retinal thinning in autism, and what I want to know is how the hell did they do that in getting the kids to stay still enough to do the test?
This is with a very, very young?
No, teenagers.
Teenagers?
But impaired.
I mean,
it was in Italy.
Correct. It is a challenge to measure retinal thickness in Alzheimer's patients. You can't get them to focus, and so the same is true with children. So, you know, I'm not the specialist, but Dr. Loudon, who's premier working with children and understanding binocular vision, is the kind of people that can do that. But I can see that being extremely difficult. But it's a flash of light. It's a flash of light. So if you're a good technician, you know, it's not a scan, it's
okay.
A flash of light. So if you have to take 1,000 flashes, maybe you'll get that image. And any good doctor, if you go to see an eye doctor and you want to get an OCT, don't let them take one flash, because, you know, some of the images that didn't show you, they're a little offset, there's some movement, it's extremely sensitive. So you want to have your doc take several images and say, okay, doc, give me the best one, you know. But yeah, it's a flash of light. Dr. Wright, how are you? Can I borrow your jacket? I love it.
Just temporarily. Thank you.
Temporarily, no doubt.
Yeah. Thank you very much for a very, very informative presentation.
Appreciate that,
I
yeah.
Really appreciate that. Since 1984 at our clinic, over 70% of those with dry macular degeneration have it either stopped or, in most cases, they have their vision restored.
Correct. Sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
The right thing to do. I mean, you've been preventing Alzheimer's disease 20 years before it formed.
This is macular degeneration, sir.
Right.
Dry macular degeneration.
Right. That's an amyloid process.
Well, it is and it isn't. Were you aware that actually the problem is in the digestive tract?
Pardon me?
The problem is actually in the digestive
tract. Oh, I agree 100%.
And what it is malabsorption of nutrients. You mentioned that zinc wasn't much good for macular degeneration. It's central if you get it to the macula.
Correct.
It really is, but you have got to get it there. These folks are either hypochlorhydric and they're not digesting their nutrients so they can be absorbed, or they're hidden gluten sensitive and they don't know they're not absorbing.
Correct. Agree 100%.
So basically, the gut is where the problem originates. It manifests in the eye. My father, who was the second patient we treated, his vision went, and by the way, we have all visions measured by an ophthalmologist or an optometrist, not us. We don't trust us for doing this.
I can appreciate that. Yeah.
His vision went from 20/80 corrected to 20/30 corrected with about 6 weeks of treatment.
Right.
And that's moderately routine. So macular degeneration, dry type, is entirely turnaroundable.
Oh, I agree. You know, the beautiful thing about the eye with its ocular, its Faustian dilemma, is that it's happening much more rapidly and much more obviously than the other neurodegenerative processes. So you're catching people at a much earlier stage, and that's a pretty common thing. And, you know, just so you know, Dr. Wright, you know, in our coaching program, we have a very robust protocol, and everything starts right here. If you don't correct that, you're out of luck. You know, a lot of people do it ass backwards. And
then you're probably also aware of the two studies that connect potential treatment for glaucoma and Alzheimer's.
Yes.
And the one from Science in April, the one that was published where 92% of the little rats had their glaucoma turned around with a niacinamide supplement. 92% were cured.
What was the supplement?
Niacinamide.
Mm-hmm.
And what it did was activate the mitochondrial
right.
complex 1, etc. Well, there was also the study at
Krebs cycle.
Also the study out of UC Irvine where, again, little rats, and these are real rats, not politicians,
right.
real rats.
Right.
Uh-huh. These, these real rats were genetically engineered to get human Alzheimer's disease. Imagine that, genetically engineering an animal to do that. And once these animals all had Alzheimer's, and you can tell how a rat has Alzheimer's by can't run the maze, you know that?
Right.
Yeah. They put them all onto niacinamide, and damned if every one of those rats didn't recover the ability to run the maze.
Right.
And the niacinamide was fixing up the Alzheimer's, genetically engineered in rats, and it was fixing up glaucoma. Nice connection there. You told us that glaucoma and Alzheimer's
right,
were
right.
connected.
You know Dr. Craig Atwood? He's sort of like
No,
that.
I do not. I
he's a gentleman that worked at Harvard, now he's at Case Western, or at University of Wisconsin. He and I have had long discussions about the animal model for Alzheimer's.
Okay.
And it's challenging because what we try to do is we try to isolate a couple different simple pathologies. But, you know, so how they stimulate amyloid in animals is to provide lipopolysaccharide.
Well, this is genetic engineering. This is
Correct.
An entirely different way of doing it.
Yeah, no, but I get that. But infection, which is tied to the immune health, the absorption, the quality of the immune system, the gut, which can get in the brain. If you don't have that component, then sometimes these therapies look better than they really are. I'm not saying they don't work, because you know, half the people we see are infection-free that still have a profound dementia. And we tend to see less of the amyloid, which we think has a more infectious etiology. But you know, I agree 100% with the gut, and antioxidant therapy will work in some instances. But we look at a constellation. It starts with the gut. I mean, cod liver oil heals the gut. You know, it helps snuff out the antagonistic bacteria and allow the other milieu to come up. But that's a monotherapy as well. I mean, it's never one thing.
Of course, what that won't do is restore digestive absorption with the cod liver oil.
Correct.
I mean,
you have
that,
to be
yeah.
triggering bile. I mean, you have to have a healthy, you have to have a healthy milieu. I mean, you have to have the right amount of acid. I learned that from you, by the way.
So thank you again very, very much. I learned a lot of things that I didn't know. Thank you.
Oh, good. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Hi there.
How are you, Daniel?
Good. I have a 56-year-old female patient with a posterior vitreous detachment. She's apparently in good health. What am I missing? What systemically is going on that can lead to PVD?
A vitreal detachment. Now, I'm going to have to give full disclosure. I'm not an ophthalmologist, so I wish Dr. Tremp was here to look at that. But usually there's an inflammatory component if there wasn't trauma. So, you know, what we normally are going to run in a case like that, and I don't have my, let me just see if I can flick a couple slides up to give you an example, because they're right down the road, but, you know, we're looking at usual suspects. We're looking at, C-reactive protein, kidney function. We're looking at, these are some of the infectious components that can contribute to the inflammatory cascade. Obviously, I think Dr. Wright is, obviously he's not only Dr. Wright, but he's Mr. Wright in this case. But, you know, getting that physiological milieu, starting with the gut, in the right place. But what we find with the infection, toxo and all these other things. Look, we have antibodies, we're fighting them. But if we're in a long-term, chronic, you know, campaign to fight these things, sometimes you need to add a little turbo to it to knock them down below the level that the immune system is able to manage. So these are often hidden, you know, Lyme disease, you know, 20% of people probably have Lyme.
Oliver, inflammatory markers were low, CRP, homocysteine, fibrinogen, things like that, and no apparent trauma to the eyes. I was just wondering, is there something I'm missing?
I wish I had an answer for that. I don't know, but sometimes with these infectious species, particularly virals, you will not see upregulated inflammation. So we're looking at CRP at 0.5. We're looking at...
That's what I used to.
Okay. Yeah. So you're doing classic
and is it true that generally those heal the PBDs without sequelae?
Yes. What I'd like you to do is send me a card, and I'll give you a card, and I'll have Dr. Tremp have a look at the real expert at this.
Okay.
I mean,
thank
you. All he does is look at cases like this. All right.